So in this session, we are going to talk about the fisheries management approaches. We have already discussed about the legislation in the country in general, but so what are the fisheries management approaches that also included, like what kind of approaches that we have, also what are the opportunities that we have, especially what we can learn from the world outside, how they are doing the fisheries management, and to see if we can get something out of the others as well. Of course, we need to have our own management system, our own management mechanisms, but at the same time, we need to learn from the others, because the fisheries, like many other industries, like you cannot manage by countries, because they are in the vast ocean, they are connected. though we have the limitations, segregated the ocean into different areas, but the fish, they don't follow, right? So that's why we need to have not only the national legislation, national regulation, but we need regional level legislation as well as the global level, some of the approaches even, right? So it's managing fisheries. It's really a difficult task, especially with the lot of issues that we have in the marine environment, right? So what are we going to learn here? What are the major issues in the global fisheries, which we have already talked a couple of times. We just try to understand again, what are the key issues and what are the management approaches and why they are needed actually. And especially to treat the different issues, especially the how to deal with the global fisheries issues. And especially like a recent type of approaches in fisheries management, something like ecosystem-based management. I'm not too sure whether you have heard about these things, but these are the sort of advanced or recent type of fisheries management approaches. So let's talk about these things as well as what it is and what kind of benefits we will have from this kind of approach. Before going into the fisheries management approaches, it has become like a sort of a mandate, right? Especially we as a signatory or signatory to the United Nations, right? So we have signed or we have agreed to go with the sustainable development goal targets. In that targets in under the 14, number 14, like 14.4, talk about by 2020 effectively regulate harvesting and end overfishing, illegal, unreported and irregular fishing and destructive fishing practices, right? Now the 2020 already gone. So at least we need to have 5 years, 10 years time to end this issue. If we are since we are a party, of course these SDGs are a voluntary guidelines, but still we have to go with the world elsewhere, right? And even by 2020 prohibited certain form of fisheries subsidies which contribute to the overcapacity and overfishing, eliminate subsidies that contribute to illegal, unreported and IUU fishing. By 2030 increase the economic benefits to small island developing states. It's called the SIDS actually, Small Island Developing Nations or States, SIDS. So that's where we have to think a lot, especially this talk about this something like a blue economy, right? So as a country, we have a mandate to go ahead with this SDG targets. So that's where the fisheries management point of view, very important aspect of this, right? We have a small video.
Imagine as a thought experiment that you live in a small village and depend on the local fish pond for food. You share the pond with three other villagers. The pond starts off with a dozen fish, and the fish reproduce. For every two fish, there will be one baby added each night. So, in order to maximize your supply of food, how many fish should you catch each day? Take a moment to think about it. Assume baby fish grow to full size immediately, and that the pond begins at full capacity, and ignore factors like the sex of the fish you catch. The answer? One. And it's not just you. The best way to maximize every villager's food supply is for each fisherman to take just one fish each day. Here's how the math works. If each villager takes one fish, there will be eight fish left overnight. Each pair of fish produces one baby, and the next day, the pond will be fully restocked with 12 fish. If anyone takes more than one, the number of reproductive pairs drops, and the population won't be able to bounce back. Eventually, the fish in the lake will be gone, leaving all four villagers to starve. This fish pond is just one example of a classic problem called the tragedy of the commons. The phenomenon was first described in a pamphlet by economist William Forster Lloyd in 1833 in a discussion of the overgrazing of cattle on village common areas. More than 100 years later, ecologist Garrett Hardin revived the concept to describe what happens when many individuals all share a limited resource, like grazing land, fishing areas, living space, even clean air. Hardin argued that these situations pit short-term self-interest against the common good, and they end badly for everyone, resulting in overgrazing, overfishing, overpopulation, pollution, and other social and environmental problems. The key feature of a tragedy of the commons is that it provides an opportunity for an individual to benefit him or herself while spreading out any negative effects across the larger population. To see what that means, let's revisit our fish pond. Each individual fisherman is motivated to take as many fish as he can for himself. Meanwhile, any decline in fish reproduction is shared by the entire village. Anxious to avoid losing out to his neighbors, a fisherman will conclude that it's in his best interest to take an extra fish, or two, or three. Unfortunately, this is the same conclusion reached by the other fishermen, and that's the tragedy. Optimizing for the self in the short term isn't optimal for anyone in the long term. That's a simplified example, but the tragedy of the commons plays out in the more complex systems of real life, too. The overuse of antibiotics has led to short-term gains in livestock production and in treating common illnesses. But it's also resulted in the evolution of antibiotic-resistant bacteria, which threaten the entire population. A coal-fired power plant produces cheap electricity for its customers and profits for its owners. These local benefits are helpful in the short term. But pollution from mining and burning coal is spread across the entire atmosphere and sticks around for thousands of years. There are other examples too. Littering, water shortages, deforestation, traffic jams, even the purchase of bottled water. But human civilization has proven it's capable of doing something remarkable. We form social contracts, we make communal agreements, we elect governments, and we pass laws. All this to save our collective selves from our own individual impulses. It isn't easy, and we certainly don't get it right nearly all of the time. But humans, at our best, have shown that we can solve these problems, and we can continue to do so if we remember Hardin's lesson. When the tragedy of the commons applies, what's good for all of us is good for each of us. TED-Ed is a nonprofit. If you value our work, please consider supporting it on patreon.com/TED-Ed.
Right. I hope you got a good understanding about what we call the strategy of the commons. Very interesting phenomenon, actually. I don't have time to go through these things, but this kind of concept is really important. So now see the management of resources. We have to think a lot on different aspects. Like it's not the single aspect, but there are so many other things linked with this kind of industry as well. So that's where we have to think management of fisheries. Something is very complex because it's not that we are just taking the fish out, but we are disturbing the whole marine ecosystem. We are taking or we're destroying the marine food webs as well. So that's where we have to think some serious concern on the fisheries management, right? Now, let's take a little bit further on the major issues with the fisheries and the tragedy of the commons. So it's mainly because of the open access nature of the fisheries. So, that we call the fisheries as the common property natural resource, or it's open access. Of course, there may be a small license fee, maybe it's just a small amount, but generally it is open access. Anyone who want to go fishing, they can do it. There is no restriction. So that's why we call it as open access. And other than water, this is the only available open access resource in the world. So that's where you have to think seriously. Because why it is called open access? There's no property rights. I mean, everyone owns fish. And because of that, the resource is depleting quite fast because everybody is trying to get their maximum because it's highly competitive. It's a natural resource. Everyone trying to get maximum share and even trying to invest a lot to get maximum resource and more than what it is needed. So we people are spending money, and as a result you ended up in low catch per unit effort, right? So individual fishermen will be getting less and less because of this competitive nature. And also even it will lead to a saturation, market saturation, because too much fish is getting. But of course, this is not something true for Sri Lanka. We don't have actually even supply for the demand, but this is true for many countries. Like this kind of situation has caused a lot of fisheries issues. In your right side, you see the cod fishery, and best example. Now you see the cod has been one of the common fish caught in this case in the Canada. I see how the catch has increased over the years, and then eventually the whole fishery was collapsed by 1992. Like even by now, the fishery has not recovered. So imagine if this happened to our tuna fish, right, for yellowfin tuna, what would happen? So that will in the future for sure, right? That's where we have to think of, right? Okay, that's another video as well.
Fish are in trouble. The cod population off Canada's east coast collapsed in the 1990s. Intense recreational and commercial fishing has decimated Goliath grouper populations in South Florida. And most populations of tuna have plummeted by over 50%, with the southern Atlantic bluefin on the verge of extinction. Those are just a couple of many examples. Overfishing is happening all over the world. How did this happen? When some people think of fishing, they imagine relaxing in a boat and patiently reeling in the day's catch. But modern industrial fishing, the kind that stocks our grocery shelves, looks more like warfare. In fact, the technologies they employ were developed for war. Radar, sonar, helicopters, and spotter planes are all used to guide factory ships towards dwindling schools of fish. Long lines with hundreds of hooks or huge nets round up massive amounts of fish, along with other species like seabirds, turtles, and dolphins. And fish are hauled up onto giant boats, complete with onboard flash freezing and processing facilities. All of these technologies have enabled us to catch fish at greater depths and farther out at sea than ever before. And as the distance and depth of fishing have expanded, so has the variety of species we target. For example, the Patagonian toothfish neither sounds nor looks very appetizing, and fishermen ignored it until the late 1970s. Then it was rebranded and marketed to chefs in the US as Chilean sea bass, despite the animal actually being a type of cod. Soon it was popping up in markets all over the world and is now a delicacy. Unfortunately, these deep water fish don't reproduce until they're at least 10 years old, making them extremely vulnerable to overfishing when the young are caught before they've had a chance to spawn. Consumer tastes and prices can also have harmful effects. For example, shark fin soup is considered such a delicacy in China and Vietnam that the fin has become the most profitable part of the shark. This leads many fishermen to fill their boats with fins, leaving millions of dead sharks behind. The problems aren't unique to toothfish and sharks. Almost 31% of the world's fish populations are overfished, and another 58% are fished at the maximum sustainable level. Wild fish simply can't reproduce as fast as 7 billion people can eat them. Fishing also has impacts on broader ecosystems. Wild shrimp are typically caught by dragging nets the size of a football field along the ocean bottom, disrupting or destroying seafloor habitats. The catch is often as little as 5% shrimp. The rest is bycatch, unwanted animals that are thrown back dead. And coastal shrimp farming isn't much better. Mangroves are bulldozed to make room for shrimp farms, robbing coastal communities of storm protection and natural water filtration, and depriving fish of key nursery habitats. So what does it look like to give fish a break and let them recover? Protection can take many forms. In national waters, governments can set limits about how, when, where, and how much fishing occurs, with restrictions on certain boats and equipment. Harmful practices such as bottom trawling can be banned altogether. And we can establish marine reserves closed to all fishing to help ecosystems restore themselves. There's also a role for consumer awareness and boycotts to reduce wasteful practices like shark finning and push fishing industries towards more sustainable practices. Past interventions have successfully helped depleted fish populations recover. There are many solutions. The best approach for each fishery must be considered based on science, respect for the local communities that rely on the ocean, and for fish as wild animals. And then the rules must be enforced. International collaboration is often needed too, because fish don't care about our borders. We need to end overfishing. Ecosystems, food security, jobs, economies, and coastal cultures all depend on it.
So, as you could understand, the problem of fisheries is really complex than what you think. Right? There are so many things associated with the fisheries and fisheries management. So that's why we need to think seriously on this issue. Right? So the overfishing is one of the key issues in the fisheries sector. And we have already discussed about the reason for overfishing, for example, the unsustainable way of fishing, the bycatch, the harmful fishing gear, and IUU fishing. They are the key things that affecting overfishing. So, and because of that, as I mentioned before, the catch per unit effort. So the individual fisherman or the individual boat is getting less and less income. That making a lot of issue for the fisherman, not only the fisherman, that will create a lot of social issues as well. It's like, it's not only like for fishing, no, even like in the country, like for the bus service, even the three-wheelers have the same issue now. There are too many three-wheelers in every junction. So which means the increase in three-wheelers doesn't mean that it's going to increase the transportation need as well. But individual three-wheeler will get less and less income. So the same issue with the fisheries. So fishermen complaining less and less income, it's obvious the reasons why it is. So now the overfishing is really a big issue that we need to concern.
Managing fisheries is a complex undertaking. One reason is that managers cannot directly observe the interactions between fish populations, fishing boats, and other marine life. Instead, they use mathematical models to predict the impacts of their management actions. Most of these models reduce complexity by focusing on a single species of fish. By estimating deaths and births, among other factors, the models calculate how many fish can be caught without depleting the population. But single species models may oversimplify another important factor, predator-prey interactions. In general, these models assume that predators eat a small and constant share of fish. In reality, the amount of fish predators consume fluctuates widely and can be a large share of the prey. If fisheries managers ignore this fact, they risk setting catch limits that are too high. Fortunately, several methods are available today to incorporate predators into fisheries management. One simple method is to use a single species model and treat predators as a second fishing fleet, estimating catch from the predator's population and diet. For a more complete picture, managers can sometimes use a multi-species model. In South Africa, scientists did this to investigate interactions between fur seals and two species of hake. The seals eat both hake species, and the larger hake species occasionally eats the smaller species. One proposal was to kill fur seals in order to increase the hake catch. But the multi-species model showed that this would have little impact on the overall catch. That's because reducing the number of seals would allow the larger species of hake to increase and eat more of the smaller species. Even when predators can't be included in a model, fisheries managers can still take them into account. The Lenfest Forage Fish Task Force recommends that when a predator-prey relationship is unclear, fishing on the prey species should be reduced by 50% or more compared to conventional levels to help protect both predators and prey.
So that's why from the beginning I mentioned that the fisheries management is not something going to be easy. And it's not that the ordinary fishing people can do, that there are a lot of science behind, right? And now we talk about different form of overfishing. Like there are at least four different ways of overfishing can occur. One form we call the growth overfishing, where if you catch fish too young before becoming the mature, or at least before getting them into a reasonable size, we call this the growth overfishing. They could have, the same fish could have given a large catch or the much weight. They should have put on much weight, even a single fish, but we lose that weight because we are catching them as small. So that will reduce the maximum yield that we can get. And that is what we call the growth overfishing. The second one we call the recruitment overfishing. That is, we are taking too many of the parent stock before they have much time to reproduce. And that will result in producing less than yes, young one in the marine environment. Right, so there won't be enough young fish to have that population for long run, or that population won't be sustainable. Right, so that's the recruitment overfishing. Then the third one we call ecosystem overfishing, because like the countries like us, we have what we call the multi-species fishery, because we rely on so many species, and particularly we are targeting the larger predatory fish. When they are not abundant, then we are going to the next level, or next level of in the food chain. Like we are going down, we call the fishing down the food web, right? And eventually the food web, the marine food web will be disrupted. And this is what we call ecosystem overfishing, right? So gradually starting from the top predators to going down to the lower level of food web and destroying the marine food web eventually. So ecosystem overfishing. The fourth one called economic overfishing. Then this concept actually a little difficult to understand, but unless you have some knowledge about what we call the fisheries economics. Just to give what it is, on your right, you see this graph with on your x-axis is the effort. That may be number of boats or number of fishermen. You say it's number of boats. And the y-axis is the catch, or it can be revenue, or if you multiply the catch by the price, then you will get the revenue. We'll say just the catch or the revenue. That's the earning. Right? So you see, when you increase number of boats, of course the cost increase like this in a linear scale. And this one is the profit. This is the profit. When there is few boats, there will be a little profit, but as you increase, there will be a point for a cost. And this is the cost curve actually. For the same cost, you will have the highest profit somewhere. Maybe not that point, maybe somewhere here, you will have the highest profit for that cost. Right, so that is actually called the effort, like a number of boats that you can operate, that you can get the maximum profit, and that is called the maximum economic yield. Right, that is the effort for that maximum economic yield. You see, if you keep on increasing the number of boats, then that will increase the revenue or the catch, but you see the profit will again decline, right? After maybe like here, the profit will go down and it will go further, and there will be something like this is called the equilibrium. The cost equals profit. And thereafter, there can't be an industry, you know, the cost equals the profit, and no private sector will be involved in this industry. And then we could be open access equilibrium. So this will end the fishing. Just like a lot of our, some of like resources has gone to like this level, and that industry won't sustain thereafter. And that is called your economic overfishing. If you fish beyond this maximum economic yield, right? Actually, previously I did a separate lecture on this, what you call the fisheries economics, but this time we don't have much time to do. If you didn't understand this one, just let me know. I will explain it with much detail. And there is a few slides later on as well, right? So anyway, so at least there are four types of different overfishing that can happen, right? So you just need to read a little bit further on this, the concept of overfishing. Right, now what going to happen with the overfishing, right? That will lead to a lot of even extinctions. Like in this case, like you might have heard about this bird called dodo, lived in the southern hemisphere, who's been extinct. Like there are so many other species being extinct that fish species will be extinct in the future as well. Maybe some of them have already extinct, but so many species in the list, in the verge of extinction. So that's going to be a big issue. Like there will be a lot of disruption to the marine food webs because of this kind of issue. So the overfishing is going to be a big issue in the future that we need to again think very seriously. I mean, the fisheries managers, they have to think very seriously on this, if not us. Like we are just the academic, we just learn about these things, but if you are a fisheries manager, then you have to think very seriously. Right. So then what we can do, right? So there are so many issues, what we can do. So that is where we have to think of the fisheries management, how we are going to do the fisheries management, because the fisheries is very important for the food security, for the job security, and perhaps even for like earning money or foreign exchange, and all sort of the other benefits that we have to think of. Then we have to manage fisheries very well. And that's where we have to think of the management of fisheries. Right? If you are to manage the fisheries, so we have to do so many things. We need to understand the biology. So about the environment where the fish live, about their ecosystems, what is their fish stock size, what are their interactions with the other organisms, how these the food webs functioning, and the relation with other biotic component in the marine environment. Right? Another biotic component, like that's where we need a lot of research on this. And that's why we have to learn about, like as biologists, we need to look into this component. Then about the catch, what is the composition? What are the species there? What is their age? What is the size of fish? Again, this is also something to do with the scientists. They have to look into this, the catch composition, which species going down, we need to understand. Then the other one, like economic aspect, the demand and the supply, you know, the economic theory is like a demand and supply. You have to match both demand and the supply. Then the management aspect, we have to control the effort, perhaps the fishing methods, the different methods to limit the fishing, fish production. Think of the better fishing gear, selectivity of the fishing gear, the timing of the fishing has to be considered. Likewise, you have to put a lot of effort on the management aspect, right? So that's where we have to think of, we need a lot of people to do this kind of a job, from the biologists to statisticians to economists and managers, together with the other, the stakeholders, the fishermen, the other stakeholders, right? That's why it's so complex, right? But just like a fisheries, now the fisheries science is so vague, especially like countries like us. We sometimes do some research, sometimes don't. So because of that, there are so many uncertainties in the fisheries management aspect sector, right? So how we can manage the fisheries? So what species to be targeted for management, right? So and what are the best way to use the managed fisheries? What are the control measures that we can use? And these things has to be considered, right? Then we need to think a lot on the management aspect, right? So there are a lot of people involved in the fisheries management. Fishers, of course, they are the key component. The other agents like NGOs and scientists from the other, like fisheries stakeholders, like boat operators, boat owners, and other related, and the coastal stakeholders, like other related industries in the coastal zone, and is that the government, the regulatory bodies. Likewise, there's so many people has to come together to manage fisheries, right? And even with them, how are we So with all this, how are we going to manage fisheries? We need to do so many things, different control methods, right? Some of the control methods may be like indirect controls, like we can put some taxation system, right? So the whole purpose of managing fisheries at the end, like control, maybe the input control or output control, which I will explain later on. Maybe from like some sort of a taxation or controlling the capacity or controlling the catch. I have even given some example, like different countries with different approaches in managing fisheries, especially input and output controls. Like in the next slide, I have given these different approaches, like how you can control the output, that is the catch. How we can control the catch. The input is the effort, like how many fishermen, how many boats, we can regulate these things, or the output. So the one of the approach in the fisheries management then, either to control the input or the output. So to do this, there are so many different ways, like some do something called the harvest control, right? You have some sort of control method. The harvest or the catch can be controlled by way of called the individual transferable quota. It's called the ITQ. I don't think you have heard these terms before. So individual transferable quotas, ITQ, and the same thing sometimes called the individual fishing quota, so IFS. And in this sense, they consider something called total allowable catch. And every fisherman, every boat will be given a maximum amount that they can catch. That is called the total allowable catch. Actually, that is from the total allowable catch, the fisherman will be given some quota. Right? There is a certain amount of fish that can be get from that particular environment, which is called the total allowable catch. And from that, the individual fisherman or the fishing boat will be given some quota. This quota system is called the individual transferable quota. Another controls are the marine reserves. Again, that will limit the inputs. Then if it is a reserve, you won't be able to go fishing in there. That's the input control. And also seasonal quotas. Sometimes some seasons, the fish won't be allowed to catch, just like lobsters. In some of the months in Sri Lanka, like in the February, October, September. So it's called the seasonal quotas. And other regulated entry, like providing license. Now you put a big amount of money for getting a license that will again control the inputs. Then efficiency of the fisher can be reduced, something like how many pieces of nets you can put in a gill net. Likewise, you can regulate, and even like output can be controlled, something like putting a tax. Like if you catch 1 ton of fish, you have to give 10,000 rupees. Likewise, for tax on the catch, so that way you can control the output. Right? So these are some of the things that some countries using for the managing fisheries, right? But how about the small scale fisheries? Like in a country like Sri Lanka, we have a small scale fisheries. Can we impose this kind of thing? Like, can we limit their catch? Like some of the small scale fishermen, their daily income may be like few hundred rupees, maybe less than 1,000 rupees sometimes, but still they have to spend a lot of money for the fishing gear and the fuel as well. And they will get a marginal profit. So can we control them? And that is the problem that we have, since we have something called this the very much the small scale fishery, not like other countries, it's very difficult to manage, right? So we have to look into different approaches in this sense, right? So there are so many different ways of the regulating the fisheries, as we discussed before, like can be like a space, like from the size of the fish can be controlled, or the by gear from the time and the space, likewise from the boundaries, or with like seasons, likewise you can have so many regulatory mechanisms. But now the problem is how we can apply for different aspects, right? So one way of fisheries management we call the giving or establishing property rights, right? Rather than it's like a open access, you give some sort of a property rights. Who can catch fish? Also give some sort of ownership for the fish. Like even in Sri Lanka, there is some this kind of a property right, especially for the beach sand fishermen. So we call it like a traditional beach sand fisherman. They have demarcated like a Madal Padu. That Padu is belong to that fisherman or their family. It's like an inherited property for them. So in that way, it is sort of a property right. Right. Even the state net fishery in the like Nigambula used to be some this kind of a property right system, but for the moment it's not anymore functioning. But that also some way of a property right. Right. Now the problem with this kind of a property right is like, especially for the migratory species like a tuna, if you give a property right for a fisherman or a group of people, but these are migratory fish. So there is no purpose of giving a property right. Even you give, they will be somewhere else the next day. So in this case, sometimes you have to give something called the territorial user right. Like the tuna in a large area will be given to a particular group. And it's called the territorial user right. So TURL, territorial user rights in fisheries, right? This is not actually practiced in Sri Lanka, but in some countries, like in the fish, in Japan, they have practiced something called territorial user right for tuna fisheries in Japan. But you need to be very careful in this kind of thing situation, because only a cooperative society, fishermen's society, is doing this, but they can manipulate. Like you can imagine what will happen to a country like us, if you given a group of people to handle the fishery, so they will freely increase the price, or they will manage like a, they can manipulate the markers, they can reduce the catch and increase the price arbitrarily. Just what is happening in these days with the sugar and then many even the rice. So same thing can apply even for fisheries, right? But this, what we call the ITQs, so individual transferable quota system, is some sort of a good management practice that some countries are using, some like in New Zealand and in Australia. It's been tested many countries, like from the fish stock, certain amount of fish, what we call the total allowable catch, will be divided among fishermen. Usually it will be like a divided among the commercial fishermen, some amount, as well as some amount will be reserved for the recreational or the traditional fishermen as well. So this kind of system is really good if we can practice for a country like us as well. Then still we will have a maximum amount that you can get. You can decide. You can catch it within 1 week, 1 month, or whole year. It's up to you. It's you decide when you are going to catch, but you have a maximum limit. Right. So this is a way of get rid of the what you call the tragedy of the commons, or the common act, what's called open access nature. so This is good, but the problem is there are some issues as well, because especially the accountability, you know, who is going to monitor that you catch this much of fish only, especially the in our countries, the fishermen or the, we are not very genuine. We are not giving these statistics, exact statistics, then there will be some issues as well. But this is one approach that you can use. The fisheries managers talking about, like, there are a lot of benefit from this kind of a management approach, what we call the individual transferable quota, that will benefit a lot of to the environment, like the less sustainable, like a more sustainable fishing, less damaging fishing gear will be used, and bycatch will be reduced, because you are given right to catch one group of fish. You are not allowed to catch anything else, so you are not taking any bycatch. Likewise, there will be a lot of economic benefits as well as social benefit as well, because you don't have to stay longer period, or you don't have to take risk in the ocean, because anyway your catch going to be limited, so you can take that safely. But again, there are some criticisms as well, because especially the giving the quotas, who's to be given this quota? But in country like us, it's not difficult, you know, the politicians will decide to whom it should be given. But of course, the quotas has to be given to traditional fishermen or the who has been in the industry for a long period of time, right? But again, there can be some monopolistic thing, like if you get together, they can manipulate the markets, even with the ITQ, right? So individual transferable quotas going to be very important. Even can be like a, can be used as a sort of a retirement fund, you know, because it's an individual transferable, but you can transfer it to someone else. When you feel that you cannot fish anymore, you can sell it for someone else, that quota. Right? So that is really good. Right. So the important thing, you know, no matter how much the regulations or the approaches that we have, but still we need like enforce this management thing. That is the difficult part in the management of fisheries. And also this management approaches has to be cost effective. If we spend a lot of money on management, it's not going to sustain. Especially that's what happened in many cases in Sri Lankan fisheries management as well. This came as like a project, spending a lot of money, but you know, there's no money left for the sustainability of the project. Then the management is also over. Right? So that's where you have to be, the management approach has to be the cost effective as well. Right. So what approaches that we have followed in our fisheries management? There are so many things. We have already discussed some of the things as well. But because of the some of the management approaches, the some of our fishing effort has been shifted from the coastal zone to the more offshore areas, something like a purse seining, because there was conflict between the traditional fishermen and the person, then they have to push the person, fisherman has to push from the coastal waters to the deep waters, right? And due to this licensing scheme, some of these open access nature has been reduced, but of course, like this, just a small amount of money you have to pay for the licensing, so it's not really going to work, right? And the other things, like we are trying to comply with the international rules and regulations as well, but they're not really coming out good. But we have been trying some sort of a community-based management approaches as well. As I discussed before, like we had this, what we call the community-based management, even in our the stake net or the cut to del fishery, several hundred years back. But now the Western world have reinvented this, what we call the participatory fisheries management or the community-based management. Now the UN the fisheries authorities are trying to give something called this community-based management. That's where the community take part in the management approach, which is a good consideration, but it's has been so difficult to deal with, especially this kind of a group of people without much education. Managing fisheries is going to be difficult from this approach, what we call the participatory fisheries management, right? And, what else we can do? Like, as I mentioned before, the stake net fishery, the cuttlebell fishery has been, we have been the participatory fisheries management approach in the history. But for the moment, these things are not anymore. But we could have developed our own way of managing fisheries. That's something the fisheries managers has to think of, right? Now, other than this participatory fisheries management, or what we call the community-based fisheries management, there is another concept what we call co-management, the fisheries co-management. A lot of people get confused is because community-based management, some people think that it is the abbreviation of co-management, is the abbreviation of community-based management. It is not. So the community-based management, where the community take part, has much contribution from the community rather than the authorities. But in the co-management, actually, as the word co means together, it's a partnership. Then managing together, especially the government authorities, the other stakeholders, the NGOs, and particularly the fishermen, that together the managing, right? It's sort of a bit complex thing, the co-management, but the fisher's knowledge, especially what we call the IK. IK, you know what is IK? Is the indigenous knowledge, because fishers have a lot of indigenous knowledge. They can use that indigenous knowledge in the management. The other, like external agent, like the researchers, the university academics, they can, and also stakeholders. The other stakeholders and the fisheries stakeholders and the government all together working for a common purpose of fisheries management, which is, this is the most appropriate way of managing fisheries actually. If we can get together to management, that could be a best approach for not only for fisheries, for any purposes actually, but that is something to think of. If any of you are going to be a fisheries manager in the future, then you have to think something like a co-management, right? There has been some trials in the, as you can see in this chart, in the Nigambu Lagoon, they have initiated something called the Nigambu Lagoon Fisheries Management Coordinating Committee, with a lot of stakeholders taking part in managing the Nigambu Lagoon fisheries. But I don't know how effective it is. You can see the situation in the Nigambu Lagoon. It's extremely polluted. There's no much fisheries there. So I don't think that's really working, this what we call the co-management in this, at least in this kind of a trial situation. But now with that, we're coming to the more recent form of fisheries management that is called the ecosystem approach in fisheries management. Ecosystem approach in fisheries management, or EAFM. So that is a sort of a complex but recent form of a fisheries management approach. If we look at what it is, let me show you a small video.
Just call it EBFM. Fisheries managers used to focus on the health of only one species when proposing fishing regulations, like where, when, or how much to fish one particular kind of fish. But then they noticed that fishing wasn't the only human activity that affected fish populations. For example, fish died when their reefs died, or when their waters warmed, or when pollution fouled the waters they breathe. The EBFM approach goes like this. If you want to preserve a certain species of fish, you have to preserve the place where they live and the species they interact with. It's a big picture approach that recognizes that the great blue whale and the humble forage fish, the kelp forest, and the deep ocean canyon are all interconnected, even if they might have different cellular plans. It's like your community. It's one thing to have a cool family, but you also need neighbors, restaurants, playgrounds, schools, and clean air to breathe. Ecosystem-based fishery management considers all the pieces of the community puzzle. Even that stinging nettle that slipped into your bathing suit last summer. So, how about saying we're all in this together 10 times fast?
So that is what we call the ecosystem-based fisheries management. As you can understand, it's going to be extremely complex phenomenon. You have to manage everything from fishers to the operators, the boat operators, to the other stakeholders, to the ecosystems, to the surrounding environment, and everything. It's a bigger picture that you are looking at. I don't know how we can do, like a country like us, with very less information on the our ecosystems and with little interest on management, little interest on science, little interest on resource management. And it's going to be extremely difficult something, a difficult task. But if we are really to manage the fisheries, these are the things that we have to look at. Just protect the ecosystem, that everything else will be protected, everything else will be intact. You can still have some resources harvested, but with little impact on the ecosystem. Like you will have everything with the in this kind of the ecosystem approach. Very complex phenomenon, but if we can do, that's the best way we can think of managing fisheries. Right, so ecosystem-based fisheries management. You look at all the human dimensions, the ecosystem dimension, as well as the fish stock dimension. Like you are looking at different dimensions in the management of fisheries. So yeah, you have to think of keeping the balance in the natural ecosystem, like the natural, how the natural system works, you have to understand, and you have to keep it intact, while still you have to use the resources harvest with keeping the balance in the natural ecosystem with least impact to the natural system, which is going to be extremely difficult something, and where we have to understand all the linkages between between the human, the ecosystem, the other organisms, and the also other resource users. Extremely complex, as we can understand, right? So, but if we can do it, that's the best way, right? So how we can approach this, what we call the ecosystem-based management, that's where there are few things to think of. That's the ecological well-being, which has to be maintained, then the human well-being has to be maintained. And top of that, we need to have something called good governance. You know this term, what we call the good governance, right? We talk about this good governance, this is the previous government, right? Previous regime. Anyway, so, but this concept of good governance is a really good concept, where you think of the ecological well-being as well as human well-being. And if we are to think of a better future, we have to think of it in really, in practical sense, what we call the good governance. And if we can maintain that, then we can really have what we call the ecosystem approach, right? Here, we have to think of the ecological well-being, that the healthy ecosystem, the biodiversity restored or maintained, the healthy oceans, healthy ecosystem, and the food webs, the food, the interaction, everything has to be maintained, while still we have to think of the well-being of the people, like the health, the education, the food security. So we have to balance between these two. At the same time, we have to be governed by the what we call the good governance. So that's where we have to, that's where I need a sort of administration or leadership with a good governance capabilities will balance these two, right? So if you can think of something in the future, this is the best thing, the good governance, right? So if anyone of you can think of a better future in the, right? So this, we need to think of this, what we call ecosystem-based fisheries management. Well, there are a lot of things to discuss about this ecosystem approach in fisheries management. You can read a bit further on this aspect. I have put a couple of sites as well for you to read, for you to think at least. Since you are the future workforce who will be managing the not only the fisheries in the country in the future. So this is something to seriously think of, this concept of the ecosystem approach, right? So this ecosystem approach in fisheries management is like a sort of a circular system where you have to plan, you have to act, and the important thing, you have to check whether you are doing right. You do some improvement and you do the same thing. Likewise, it's like you continuously improve the system. That's how it should work, because this is so complex, so you won't be able to do it first time, maybe not second time even. So that's why you have to keep on trying with different approaches until you get, because it's so complex something. Right. But that's where I need a stronger and more science-based legislation and policies, right? Not just the vague policies, like whether we are going for organic farming or something like that. But you need a strategy, you need the science behind. How are we going to do it? What is our, the approach, how we are going to do it? This is like, you need a lot of things. You need a stronger plan, long-term plan, if you are to do this kind of approach, and a strong management action. Right? It's not like a vague, you need to have very strong legislation, as well as the, we need a stronger leaders who can keep this as intact. Since they are science-based, well-planned programs, then you can implement these things, because we have a science, we have a reason why you are doing it. If you don't have a reason why you are doing it, then it's going to be utterly failure, right? So that was happened in many cases. So in this ecosystem approach, as I mentioned, there are so many things to think of, the good governance, the different scales you have to work on. Increase participation from different, just like the co-management, we need to get together a lot of people from different level, right? And we'll need a lot of cooperation and coordination from local, regional, international level. And more importantly, the management approach has to be adaptive, right? Not just a plan, but it has to be adaptive. You have to change its bit and see how it works. If it is not working, you check and recheck, and that's how it should work, right? So So if now we put, if you look at this ecosystem approach in fisheries management, you see like it sits above everything else that what we talk about the management, right? Not like the co-management or the conventional fishery management or even the community-based fishery management or other like a spatial planning, like, you know, like some sort of other plans. And there are something called integrated coastal zone management. If you put everything together, even the ecosystem approach will still on top of everything, because ecosystem approach will be like a, all together, everything, like this will include everything. So that's something you can, if you can think of a better management in the future, that will be the best approach that we can think of for fisheries management. Right? So in this management, especially if you are thinking of a ecosystem approach, or even without an ecosystem based approach, still you need a protected area. If you are thinking of managing fisheries, the protected area is going to play a key role. That is something we need to think seriously again, to have a network of marine protected area, right? It's not just a one or two, but we need a network. Like if you have a network of protected areas, then each protected area will be like a benefited from one another. Like fish can go from one to another, will be protected there, not like one. Like, and we need more like a marine reserves, particularly what we call the fisheries reserves. A protected areas designated for managing fisheries. Right. So far, actually, we don't have something really called the marine reserve, fisheries reserves. We have the marine protected area. They are more or less for like protecting coral reefs or some like aquatic birds. But there are some special areas we call special area management or the special management areas in the for the fish, but they are not really what we call the fisheries reserve. That's something we need to think of. At least the fisheries managers need to think of, right? So why it is needed something called the marine protected areas? There are a lot of benefits, what we call the win-win solutions, like the protected area will provide the protection for the fish as well as some protection for the fishermen as well, because protected areas will keep on producing new fish. That is like a safe haven for the fish. They will produce young ones and they will go out of the protected area and still the fishermen can catch them. So it's a win-win solution. So if you have a protected area, there are a lot of benefits, like that will definitely increase the fish production, the fish biomass, the total catch, even the fish size will be increased, because the fish will have time to breed. They can like become, they can increase their size before catching into the fishing gear in this protected area, right? And there will be long-term benefit from having a marine protected area. And then there is something called a spillover effect. Let me explain this one. when you're deciding a protected area, so how you are going to decide what should be the size of the protected area? So this is actually, if it is too small, like if you are like in the ocean, if you are protecting this kind of a small area, this has no any meaning actually, because all the fish that within the protected area will be go out and there won't be any conservation meaning. Like even for fisheries, it won't support. If it is a very large fisheries reserve, so this will have like, this will protect the fish, but it won't support the fishermen because they don't have chance to go out, because huge area. But that's where you have to think of a management protected area in the middle size. Then some fish will be preserved where some will go out, which called the spillover effect. Some of the fish will go out where still fishermen can catch them, but some of them will be protected. Right? That's where we have to think of. So we see, if you are thinking, even thinking of a marine protected area, you have to use a lot of science, not just demarcating area as a protected would not any help. You have to think of a lot, what is the home range of the fish, how long they can swim. Like, likewise, you need to collect a lot of data before making something, right? Even last year, I gave this question asking, like, if you are deciding a marine protected area, what is the size that you would be thinking of? Like, most of the students got it wrong, actually. Actually, I have given a similar, even a diagrams, but most of them got it wrong. I don't know why it is. I hope they didn't try to understand what it is. Right? So at least by now, you know what is this site. Right? Now, in some of these protected areas, actually, they can be like a multiple use type of protected areas. Right? Some areas may be some allowed for recreational purposes, some for fishing as well. But at the same time, some areas will be no-take zones, like here, this example from South Africa. There is a certain area, it's no-take zone. No one is allowed to go there for fishing or for any purpose. Only for research purposes will be allowed, still with some permission. Just like a part in the Singharaja, there is a strict protected area. Likewise, even in the protected area, you can have this zonation, some buffer zone, some areas allowed for recreational or exploitation, but whereas still you have a no-take zone. And this kind of system will work both for the community as well as the fish as well. Right? So that's something that we need to think of. And the right, so the no-take areas are one way of fisheries management, and the still you can have some marine protected areas like seasonal or temporary managed areas, like maybe during the spawning season, maybe some will be protected or some areas will be protected. Right? These kind of examples are there in Japan. In Sri Lanka, we don't have seasonal MPS. And the other thing is the multiple use MPS, as we have discussed already. So marine protected area is going to be a really important concept. And sometimes the scientists call it as the hope spots. That will be the only the hope for the future if you are thinking of managing the fisheries and as well as the other marine resources as well as the marine organisms. So this protected area is going to play a good role. And it's very important, right? So other than that, like the authorities doing this kind of thing, what else we can do? Like as an individual, what we can do to manage fisheries? As an individual, what I can do? But there are something even individual people can do, individual public can do. Something like what you call the seafood choice. You know, in that some countries, there are consumers have choice which fish to be eaten. Of course, even we have the choice, but it is not like it mostly decides on the price sometimes. I just call the eco-labeling. There are some scientific method of eco-labeling fish, like in this case, in some countries, like, you know, if you go to a restaurant, they will have a list, like this kind of card. They will have all these different type of fish, both this red fish and red labeled and green labeled. It is your choice. If you are like more concerned about the environment, so these red labeled fish are more threatened fishes. They are not caught in a sustainable way. They may be endangered, but still they are available. But you choose, as a consumer, you have a choice. If you're more environmental concerned, then you will for a green list in the restaurant. Even in the food stall, you will select like this list may be advertised, like in the, like some fish may be good and bad. If they are extremely like threatened, then they will be in the red listed or maybe green listed. Like this kind of a eco labeling is some countries already practicing for consumer choice. So you will decide whether you concern the environment or not, right? So that is, rather than having a lot of regulation, the consumer will have the right of doing this, right? And there are a lot of organizations who are doing this kind of eco-labeling, what we call eco-labeling, right? What is the best, good, void, right? Even there may be not rated, like MSC is called Marine Stewardship Council. They are offering this kind of eco-labeling, right? Likewise, there are so many other, like Friends of the Sea, Sea Toys. In the future, like now a lot of countries applying this kind of eco-labeling. Like without this kind of eco-labeling, sometimes in the future, you won't be able to export fish to some countries. Like you have to label this fish has come from a sustainable source. You have to have that tag label. Like even you should be able to trace, like if you get a fish from US, but if they are caught in Sri Lanka, there should be a barcode stating like where in Sri Lanka they caught, when, using what kind of fishing gear, whether it's come from a sustainable stock. Like you need to give some certain information in that barcode. Like this kind of thing is going to be in the future, right? So we think the fisheries management going to be something extremely complex thing in the future than what we think now, right?
People have relied on the oceans as a source of food and for their livelihoods for thousands of years. As technology has advanced, we have become capable of fishing more intensively. So looking after the oceans and the resources they provide is more important now than ever before. If the oceans are to be healthy, productive and full of fish in the future, we have to fish sustainably. Sustainable fishing reduces environmental impacts, leaves more fish in the sea and harms fewer marine animals. Sustainable fisheries have good management practices. The Marine Stewardship Council standard allows fisheries to show that they are well managed and that they fish in a sustainable way. The MSC uses its blue eco label to identify seafood that has come from sustainable fisheries certified to its standard. The eco label is already displayed on tens of thousands of products in over 100 countries around the world. Consumers who want to play their part in maintaining and improving the health of the oceans can look for and choose seafood with a distinctive blue MSC eco label. It is vital that we safeguard the ocean's resources and protect people's livelihoods for the future. To do this, we need to work together.
Right, this is not really an advertisement, right? But it is just one organization doing the eco labeling, but there are some other the organizations as well. But most of them are actually non-profit organizations who are doing this kind of eco labeling. But as I said, this is going to be very important in the future. All the food that import or export, they might need to have this kind of eco labeling. Without that, especially you won't be able to export fish to other countries. Right? That's something need to think of, right? So that is the very important thing what we call the eco labeling. Very briefly, there are so many things to talk about in related to eco labeling. Even in Sri Lanka, there are some the fish exporters already got this eco label. So in the future, definitely most of them have to get this, right? So, what we can do, right? as I mentioned before, no matter how much regulation rules we have, but still we need to have like our willingness to manage these resources. Like there need to be a contribution from the different sectors, not just the administrators, but also the for individual. We also have should have some responsibility in managing fisheries. So that's where we can think of even individual, right? So as individuals, we can do our role to manage fisheries. Like there are a few slides like about the fisheries bioeconomics. I already mentioned about that previously, the fisheries bioeconomics model. And so you can read this. There are three slides on that as well. If you didn't understand that one, or if you don't understand, just let me know. We can discuss. So use this. Actually, the fisheries bioeconomics means like you are linking the biological principles with the economic theories. You are putting together the biology, the biological concept, the management, and the economic concept together. That's how we get this fisheries bioeconomics model. It's like a separate subject to talk about the fisheries bioeconomics. But for the moment, we just need to know what it is, and then what are the principles behind this, what we call the fisheries bioeconomic model, right? So you may read on that. So we as a country, if you are thinking of better manage fisheries, what should we do? There are certain suggestions here. We need to think of more environmental friendly fishing gear, and we have to ban the non-sustainable or disturbing fishing gears. Of course, some are already, but we have to act responsibly. We have to reduce the post-harvest losses. We have to set the size limit for fish, but we are catching smallest fish to the largest possible. Since we don't have, for many fish, we don't have a size limit. Like we need to increase our fish production from the lagoons. They are almost non-productive, our lagoons now. Used to be a very productive lagoons that we had, but now with the pollution and weeds and siltation, most of the lagoons are very shallow now. They have to be increased, right? And even the inland water bodies, we have to increase. Like in the aquaculture has to be developed. That would be the future. And the with that, all these different culture methods we have to improve in the future, because by now we know that the marine fisheries has come to sort of a maximum level, or we have gone beyond that. There is no future to increase the marine fisheries sector. Only the approach we can use is to divert this to a different the fishing methods like aquaculture would be the only hope that we will have for the future. Right, so that's all about the fisheries management. I was trying my best to explain this concept of fisheries management with the available time. And I know that there's a lot of different groups here, different with the different interests, but I was trying my best to put everybody into some sort of a common ground. Of course, the fisheries management is a very complex subject, as you already understand. but if you are thoroughly into this subject, you will learn these things. I mean, especially if you are going to learn further in the fisheries management, I mean, which will definitely will be helpful, right? So